day. This is Radio Rick Spector from Moviehouse Productions. When you had to choose up baseball games in Philly during the early 60s, nearly everyone, including me, wanted to be Johnny Callison. Johnny could run, field hit, had a rifle arm, and for a medium-sized man, he had great power. He looked like a movie star. Callison almost led us to a World Series in 1964. And for just too few shining years, Johnny was clearly the sports idol of our city. Now, we're going to welcome Professor John Rossi to reflect on the life of Johnny Callison. John is a retired professor of history at LaSalle University, where he taught for 57 years. He's the author of 8 books, including 4 on the role baseball plays in American life. He is involved with the Society for American Baseball Research, and he won the Macmillan Research Award in 1998 for an essay on Bill Veeck's claim that he was the first to integrate baseball. Good morning, John. How you doing?
Not bad at all.
Great. John, what got you interested in the life and career of Johnny Callison?
I was at Notre Dame, working on my master's degree, and I came home from Notre Dame the day that Gene Mock was hired as the manager of the Phillies. So that 1960 team that he took over was the first team that I followed with real intensity because I found him such an interesting and fascinating person.
John, Johnny's story could have been taken out of that book, The Grapes of Wrath. The bleakest days of the Depression. Callison family came from Oklahoma to Southern California, where John learned his craft. Bakersfield, California.
All the Okies wound up.
That's right. What were Johnny's early baseball days like in Bakersfield?
The teachers at his school were really impressed by his athleticism. The one teacher remarked that he could run faster backwards than the other kids could run regular, and that he played baseball. He played all the sports, but he was particularly good at baseball. And as he said, I think himself, that it became kind of like the only thing that really interested him for other than girls.
Now, he was quite a phenom. He was dubbed the next Mickey Mantle, correct?
Yeah. The White Sox signed him, and he had one really phenomenal year in the minors, and that's when the White Sox began blowing this up as the next Mickey Mantle, because he could do many of the things, and in some ways, he was like Mantle. He was a kind of a two-thirds version of Mantle. And I don't think this did him any good being built up like him. Imagine being told you're the next Mickey Mantle.
Put a lot of heat on him. Well, things didn't go that great for Johnny and for the White Sox. What were the circumstances that brought him to the Phillies?
Well, the Phillies were in the process of rebuilding. The 58 and 59 Phillies teams were among the worst that they ever fielded. You'd have to go back almost to the bad days of the early 40s to find teams as bad. The 59 team was one of the worst that they had put on the field. And the Whiz Kids were all dying off, or, they were finished. So they brought in a new general manager, a man named John Quinn, who has just been put on the wall in the Hall of Fame. Yeah, John Quinn was a pretty shrewd guy. And he was an old baseball. He wasn't, if you talk to some of the players that had to deal with him, they said he was impossible to deal with as far as getting any money out of him. But anyway, Quinn got the approval to rebuild the team. And so that whole 59 squad was almost completely, gotten rid of. And they were starting, they had some younger players, and they were going to try to change the face of the team. And so one of the things he did was to make a trade. He sent the best Phillies player from the 59 team, which is not saying much, a third baseman named Gene Freeze, and he sent Freeze to the White Sox for Johnny Callison.
What was Johnny's relationship with Gene Mock?
Mock saw him right away as something special. The 60 team was all new players, and actually there were two outfields. There was a right-handed hitting outfield and a left-handed hitting outfield. And Callison, Tony Gonzalez, and a fellow named Tony Curry were the left-handed hitting outfield. And that's where I started to notice, this is like mid-60s, I start noticing this Callison. There was something about him. You could see why Mock spotted that same kind of talent. There was talent there. Maybe he didn't believe in himself yet. And then Mock began a campaign where, I mean, he was tough on rookies, and most rookies were scared of him. But he set out to build up Callison's confidence, I believe.
Yeah, in fact, he was called Gene Mock's pet.
Yeah, he was.
Johnny
He was called
Callison.
Mock's pet. And, you know, the famous quote that Mock said, there's nothing he can't do on a baseball field. He can throw, he can hit, he can run, and he can hit with power. And he even said, Mock, and this is an embarrassing thing, I imagine how Callison felt, but he's the best raw talent to show up in the National League since Willie Mays. Well, there were a couple guys, like somebody named Hank Aaron. He showed up after Mays. And there was Frank Robinson. He showed up after Mays. Roberto Clemente showed up. Yeah. I met him once years and years ago. And, you know, I introduced myself and said how much I admired him. And, you know, like some people, you could see they really kind of absorb and that kind of comment. You could see he was kind of, even this is years after he played, he was kind of chagrined about it. He didn't want to talk about himself.
Let's talk about the infamous 1964 Phillies. Johnny was one of the wonder children. What happened that year?
1964, I was an instructor at LaSalle, and they told me that if I finished my PhD, they would raise my salary by $1,100. I would be making $5,400. So I had to finish this. And I had set aside the summer. I was going to write it during the summer. And then I got caught up in that team. And I almost didn't make it because I spent so much time going to the games. I went almost every weekend when they were home. And just getting, you know, involved in it. I said in my 64 book, the only good thing came out of this, that I met my wife around that time. And so even though it was a disastrous September, it was a good one for me that way. 64 season looked like it was going to be a good one anyhow, because they signed a new pitcher, Jim Bunning. And it looked like the Phillies would have a really strong pitching staff. They started off the season very well. They beat good teams, and they were close to first place. They're never much further down than third or fourth, and then only by a game or two, until around June when they took off. And by early July, they were in first place, and they stayed in first place, I think it's from, if I'm not wrong, July 16th to when they collapsed in September. But they played really good ball, and they played Gene Mock baseball. And Gene Mock baseball was hit and run, bunt, take advantage, play for one run. His theory was play for one, get three or four. And something that sometimes modern teams ought to think about. So they only had one weak player defensively, and that was a fellow who was pretty good the other way around. That was Richie Allen.
Pretty good, I would say.
Yeah, he was pretty good the other way, yeah.
It ended in infamy, that 10-game losing streak. And how did Johnny perform during those 10 games?
Well, when the Phillies got into September and it was getting very close, Wes Covington had who was a pretty solid hitter, but not much else. Covington said, now it's time for the pros to stand up and take this team the final way. Well, the pros didn't do much, but Callison and Richie Allen, they carried the weight of that team in those 10 or 12 games. So
yes,
they did the job, but the rest of the team just went into the worst funk you could see.
And Callison actually came in second as most valuable player.
He'd have been MVP.
One more big year for Johnny Callison in 1965. High mark for home runs with 32, and then a rapid decline. What happened, John?
Nobody knows for sure. I did a piece on him one time, and I used a quote that he said, and that was, I'm the world's worst worrier. And he almost seems to have lost confidence or began to doubt himself. You know, if you went the games in 64 and 65, he looked like he was ready to hit almost every time he went up. And he didn't seem to be intimidated by left-handers. You know, he had a home run off Sandy Koufax. Can you imagine how many left-handers hit home runs off Sandy Koufax in his career? He just didn't look the same. He tried different things. He tried wearing glasses. He got Carl Yastrzemski's workout program and went into that. And even Mach couldn't figure it out.
Yes, and then some not very productive years with the Cubs and the Yankees. And Johnny retired from baseball in 1973. He lived a long time after that until 2006. Yeah. What was life like for Johnny after baseball?
He wanted to get back in baseball. But, you know, he wasn't the kind of guy that could push himself. He couldn't. He wasn't the kind of guy that buttered up people. But he drifted from job to job. He was a bartender. He sold cars. As a matter of fact, my brother and I went to look for a car just because he was selling them. But the day we go, he wasn't there. There's a neighborhood bar called the Glenside Pub. And Johnny lived in walking distance of it. And I was talking to the owner one time, and I saw a big picture up there of Johnny Callison. And I said, "Do you know him?" He said, "Every afternoon he'd come in 4 o'clock, get one beer and a pack of cigarettes, and sit, smoke the cigarettes, drink the one beer, and then go home." You know, that's kind of a sad.
Yes.
Sad. I mean, you know, today it's not because they make so much money, but the players of Callison's time, a lot of them didn't have an educational background. They didn't know what to do with themselves after that, you know, and they wound up with either bad jobs or no jobs. Part of the tragedy was he just was not the kind of aggressive personality that he could have stayed around in baseball. Because actually, if you interviewed him, and I heard him interviewed once or twice, if you got him on a talking, he was pretty good. He knew what he was talking about when he talked about baseball.
John, how should fans of Philly baseball history remember Johnny Callison?
Well, of course, the tragedy is nobody knows who he is. It's people like you and I who know who he is. I grew up in Olney, so Del Ennis, because he was from my neighborhood. The other two players who I really felt a strong identification with, one was Johnny Callison, and the other reminded me of Johnny Callison, and it was Chase Utley. I think Callison had the same kind of qualities that Utley had, with one big difference. He didn't have that kind of confidence that Utley had.
John, thanks so much. Let's conclude our interview fittingly with Johnny Callison's greatest moment. We'll show a little film clip here when he faced Dick Raddatz in that 1964 All-Star game. John Rossi, thanks so much. It's been a delight.
Thank you. I enjoyed it.
Later, with two out, two men on, reliever Dick Raddatz faces Johnny Callison. And there it goes. That's the ball game. A three-run homer by the sensational young star of the equally sensational Philadelphia Phillies.